welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship podcast. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following traditional worship service was recorded on Sunday, September 18th, 2016, at our 9 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Edgar Schambach. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com.
Invite the congregation to stand. Welcome to worship this morning at St. Paul's. We sing the entrance hymn, Let All Things Now Living. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you. Alleluia! Praise God from heaven. Praise Him from the mountaintops. Praise Him, all you His angels. Praise Him, all you His warriors. Praise Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, you morning stars. Praise Him, high heaven. Praise Him, heavenly rain clouds. He set them in place from all time to eternity. He gave His orders, and that's it. Mountains and all hills, apple orchards and cedar forests, wild beasts and herds of cattle, snakes and birds in flight. Let them praise the name of God. It's the only name worth praising. His reign exceeds anything in earth and sky. He's built a monument, His very own people.
Praise Him, all who love God,
Israel's children.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of abundance, you have poured out a large measure of earthly blessings. Our table is richly furnished, our cup overflows, and we live in safety and security. Teach us to set our hearts on you, and not these material blessings. Keep us from becoming captivated by prosperity, and grant us in wisdom to use your blessings to your glory and to the service of humankind. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated.
My shepherd is the Lord.
We are moving the children's time to right before the sermon. Last Sunday we mentioned there are over 800 scriptures that speak to God's wisdom for how we manage our home finances and live with all the blessings that God gives us. We'd like to show you a video clip that just captures some of those scriptures. Then we'll hear the word of God for today's sermon.
Proverbs 21:10, in the house of the wise are stores of choice food and oil.
Proverbs 22:7, the rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender.
Proverbs 13:22, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children.
1 Timothy 5:8, but if anyone does not provide for his own, especially for those of his household,
he's denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever.
Proverbs 6:1 and 2, my son, if you become surety for your friend, if you have shaken hands in pledge for a stranger, deliver yourself.
2 Corinthians 9:7 and 8. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or out of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you,
that you will always have sufficiency in all things and may have an abundance for every good
work. Matthew 6:24. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate one and love the other,
or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and wealth.
Romans 12:2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Money is referenced over 800 times in the Bible.
Let's learn how to handle money God's way
with Financial Peace University.
Lesson today is from the book of Proverbs. One who walks in integrity will be safe, but whoever follows crooked ways will fall into the pit. Anyone who tills the land will have plenty of bread, but one who follows worthless pursuits will have plenty of poverty. The faithful will abound with blessings, but one who is in a hurry to be rich will not go unpunished. To show partiality is not good, yet for a piece of bread, many may do wrong. The miser is in a hurry to get rich and does not know that loss is sure to come. Whoever rebukes a person will afterward find more favor than one who flatters with the tongue. Anyone who robs father or mother and says, "That is no crime," is partner to a thug. The greedy person stirs up strife, but whoever trusts in the Lord will be enriched. Those who trust in their own wits are fools, but those who walk in wisdom come through safely. Whoever gives to the poor will lack nothing, but one who turns a blind eye will get many a curse. When the wicked prevail, people go into hiding, but when they perish, the righteous increase. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God, teach me lessons for living so I can stay the course. Guide me down the road of your commandments. I love traveling this freeway. Divert my eyes from toys and trinkets. Invigorate me on the pilgrim way. Deflect the harsh words of my critics. But what you say is always so good. Stand.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 16th chapter. And this is the appointed lesson here in the fall for us, and it ties in so well with our journey of momentum. Then Jesus said to the disciples, "There was a rich man who had a manager, and charges were brought to him that this man was squandering his property. So he summoned the manager and said to him, 'What is this that I hear about you? Give me an accounting of your management, because you cannot be my manager any longer.' Then the manager said to himself, 'What will I do now that my master is taking the position away from me? I'm not strong enough to dig. I'm ashamed to beg. I have decided what to do so that when I am dismissed as manager, people may welcome me into their homes.' So, summoning his master's debtors one by one, he asked the first, 'How much do you owe my master?' He answered, 100 jugs of olive oil. He said to him, 'Take your bill, sit down quickly, make it 50. And he asked another, 'And how much do you owe?' And he replied, 100 containers of wheat. He said to him, 'Take your bill and make it 80. Well, his master commended the dishonest manager because he had acted shrewdly. The children of this age are more shrewd in dealing with their own generation than are the children of light. And I tell you, make friends for yourselves by means of dishonest wealth, so that when it is gone, they may welcome you into the eternal homes. Whoever is faithful in a very little is faithful also in much. And whoever is dishonest in a very little is dishonest also in much. If then you have not been faithful with the dishonest wealth, who will entrust to you the true riches? And if you have not been faithful with what belongs to another, who will give you what is your own? No slave can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or to be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth." This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. I want to welcome our children forward. And while I'm welcoming children forward and they're coming forward, ushers are going to be going to everyone in the pews, also all the choir and the folks up here, handing out an envelope. We want every person to take an envelope. It says, "Do not open until sermon." The actual sermon will begin shortly. We're going to do a little game activity with the kids and every adult. So ushers, be giving out the envelopes. And kids, come on up. Older kids, too. I'm going to need your help as well. I'm going to have a game started in just a moment. Here you go, Bill. No, give them to the kids. Guys, ready for a game? Guess what? Today's game is not only you guys and some of the other kids here. It's going to be everybody that's going to join us in the game. It's going to be part of our sermon. And there are rules with every game, right? So I got to explain the rules to you. Don't open the envelopes just yet. But let me explain the rules of the game. Rule number one. Whatever is in the envelope, you need to give it away. And you just keep on giving it and giving it away, because people are going to be giving you what's in their envelopes, and what they give you, we want you to give that away too. Got the first rule? What's in here? What are you going to do? Give it away. Rule number two. If someone gives you what's in their envelope, you need to say thank you. You need to accept the gift. You can't turn the gifts away. Can't say no thank you. You need to say thank you. Four rules, but here's rule three. Rule number three. If I give you what's in my envelope, you can't give me what's in your envelope. You need to take what I gave you, what's in your envelope, and give it to somebody else. Okay? We can't kind of do an exchange. Got to give it to somebody else. And the final rule is, if I give you what's in my envelope or in my hands, a part of it or all of it, I can't give it to you, whatever I have a second time. I have to go to a different person. Okay? So let's open the envelopes. See what we got. Open your envelope. Open your envelope. Just tear it open. You guys get envelopes?
Wait, do they open theirs too?
Everybody. Oh. Everybody open them. Guys, Usher, you guys think we need some up here yet?
Three more
envelopes up front.
Wait, I don't have one.
Four envelopes.
Do you have one?
I have one. I opened mine. $3 $1 bills. Not every day you come to church and get $3 $1 bills, but today we're getting. Can't. Let me help you. You're just so gentle with this. See how I do it? I just tear it. Okay. Everybody got $3 $1 bills. Now, just a few moments, and if everybody's standing, moving into the center aisles, if you're not able to move around, we'll come to you. I know we've got a couple of different folks that have some mobility challenges right now, and that's okay. We'll come to you in the course of the game. We're going to do this for a few minutes. Then we're going to gather back and talk about what we experience. Some of you at the end are going to have some money in your hand. Some of you may not have much. Some may not have any. I don't know. We'll talk about what to do with the money at the end of the exercise. Kids are a part of it. All of you are a part of it. You're going to have to move around. The rules are keep giving it away. Thanks to a generous benefactor, we can do this today. And he wants us to be giving the money away. And you heard the rules. Don't, you got to say thank you. Can't say no. And when you give it, when you receive it from someone, you have to take yours and whatever they gave you and go to someone else. And don't go to the same person twice. So everybody up. Have some folks step into the center aisle, into the side aisles, or however you need to get to move around. Choir's going to have to come down this way shortly. And let's start. I'll tell you when it's over. Come on, guys. Let's start giving money away. Everybody return to their seats. Let the giving stop for a moment. Hold on to whatever you still have in your hands. Don't put it in your pockets. Everybody out there in Radio Land is wondering, what happened? I'm just curious, how many of you have the same number of dollars you started with? Hold up your hand. Got a few hands. How many of you have no dollars at this moment? A lot of hands. They were pretty good, giving it away. How many of you need two hands to hold what was given you? Hold up a hand. You got a few hands going up. Yeah. They cashed in, huh? Well, let me tell you what to do with the money. These are kind of also with the guidance of our benefactor. Don't put the money in the offering plate. None of this money is to go into the offering plate. It's to go beyond here. If you have money, be it just a dollar or two or quite a few dollars, if you have a really dire need, and that does happen even within our own midst, a medical need, going to have trouble putting food on the table, got a utility bill that's just hanging over you, and they're calling you about it. You can use the money, if you got some of that money, toward that essential need. If your essential needs are taken care of, we want you to use whatever money you have to bless someone beyond our gathering here. If you go to Perkins today and you go to tip, make it a bigger tip. Guarantee your wait staff are living paycheck to paycheck. Order a pizza tonight, and you tip the pizza person, pizza delivery person, and you tip them more. If you got a neighbor who's just barely eating because they don't have a lot of food or they're going through a lot of troubles. We have a neighbor just across the way from us. We just learned she's just eating sandwiches. Her husband's dying in a nursing home. So we're going to be reaching out there to help. That's what we're going to do with the money. So don't put the money you have in the offering plate. Use it in particular ways to bless others. That's what part of our momentum journey is about. Now what I want to ask is, what did you experience? There was a lot of laughter. Why was it so much fun? Why was there so much laughter giving money away and you just kept on giving it and giving it? Why was that so much fun? You're given more than you received. What else did you experience? Why was it so free to give this money away? Made people smile. And you're going to do this tomorrow, right? You're going to go to Walmart, just take out your wallet, take a lot of money with you, and just, right? I don't think, if you are, I'm going to be there. What's the difference? Was it easier giving it away when it wasn't your own? Yeah, Timmy knows because she's been on a lesson. It's easy to give the money away when it's not your own. Say that again. Easy to give it away when it's not your own. Think about that. Are you connecting that to a spiritual truth? The money we gave away, not our own. Fun to give. The money in my wallet, the money in your purse, the money you will exchange all through the week and coming months, the money in your accounts, none of it is really our own. We have it only for an earthly journey, and we can't take it with us. Who does it belong to? God. Everything. The scriptures say this in so many places. Everything we have is from God. It's on loan from God for the earthly journey. And it's to bring joy to our lives, sustenance to our households, security for our well-being. And it is to be a blessing unto others, be it in the church, our community, our world. God says, I have placed you in dominion over everything, manage it well on my behalf. That includes everything he has given us, our money too. Manage it well and be my image. Don't be the image of the other masters of the world who have so much to say about money, especially your money, my money. Be my image. That's a big lesson to learn. It's all God's. And how that frees us, especially here with the giving. What a joy it brought to us. Second lesson. I saw just a few hands go up saying I ended with the same amount I started with. And choir, really? You gave it all away? What a choir. And act like you really got a lot, I'm saying, huh? Leave it to the confirmants. Teenagers. Got 49, right? 49 in confirmation this year? 49 confirmants. We began a study this last week, learning about who we are, how valuable we are to God, and what we do with things that also have value, like money. It's going to take us through the fall. Wave did it, too, with the young children Sunday school joins today. But everyone started with three, but it all ended unequally, right? That's okay. But that was just in a few minutes. Now look at the world. Look at our country. Complex economic systems at work, and millions of financial transactions taking place. Quickly, it becomes an unequal playing field. We got the super wealthy. We have wealthy, upper class, middle class, lower class, impoverished people on the streets. And that's the way the world usually works. Unequally, unfairly. And from the perspective of God, this is how God looks at it. He says, those of you who have a lot, even those of you who just have some, have a special place in your heart for those who are impoverished, those who have nothing, those who are on the streets. And as a nation, as a community, as a people of God, that needs to be in our heart. And all the rest of us, whether it's to the super wealthy or not so much, God looks at it this way. And he says, it's not how much we have. It's not how much we think we deserve. Whether life is fair to us or not, what counts from the perspective of God, what he's really looking for, is what's in the heart. Is your heart in the right place? Are you managing what I have given you, be it a lot or a little, to my glory? Do you have a gratitude in your heart? Or are you just kind of bitter when it comes to money? Do you have gratitude? Do you have that spirit of generosity? And can you sleep at night when it comes to these things? Do you know my peace in the midst of all of these material decisions? Are you honoring me in this regard? Faithful in all these things? That's the concern of God. During our 10-week journey of momentum, we began a conversation last week and here in church again this week. We're going to return to it in worship again some weeks down the road. The conversation's going to move into the everyday kind of conversations you might be having, and certainly in our classes and certainly in our mission work. But we're talking about money in a particular way because, as we saw, it is a key theme of Scripture, over 800 passages. They touched on just a few, a couple here today, and what's read from the Bible. It is an important conversation, always, for God's people, and I would say it is a critical conversation here at the beginning of the 21st century. Where we are at today as an American people is not where we were 50 years ago. And some of you are old enough to know there's been a big change. Where we're at today now is we're a nation of debtors. And I just don't mean the government. I'm talking about people. Almost all of us. 1 in 10 managing money well. Stats continue to show. Remember the balloons last week? 7 in 10, 70% of households, paycheck to paycheck. The end of the month, wondering, where did it all go? How will I ever get ahead? 20%, either on the brink of financial ruin, living a nightmare, or in a nightmare. But only 1 in 10 managing money well. We're a nation of debtors. We're a nation of incredible consumption. All of us, I think just about all of us, can go in our house and look around and say, gee, where did all this stuff come from? Some of us might even say, gee, what was I thinking? We have 3-car garages, and I'm always amazed when we can only get 1 car in the garage, or maybe 2, because the 3rd spot is usually reserved for a lot of stuff. Maybe the whole garage. Attics, basements, we got closets we haven't opened in months and we're afraid to open it lest it come tumbling out. We have rooms in our houses we haven't entered in probably weeks or maybe a few months. It's crazy. We have become so consumed with stuff. It's important to be having this conversation because this kind of living as a people has brought so much heartache to the lives of people. I've sat just in the last 18 months with people who have had millions to their name and yet are in the verge of ruin, desperate, saying, can't believe I'm in this situation. I sat with a widow from our congregation, came into my office some months ago in tears because she lost everything, and was ready to end her life. That was how desperate she was. Couldn't see a way out. She lost everything in a financial scheme. Actually, it was a scheme. She didn't know it was a scheme. Because she didn't understand it. And everyone in between are at risk as well, it seems. I was reading the newspaper on Thursday. Betty said, you got to check out the Silver Salute section. Told you last week the 65 and overcrowd is a prime area for the financial institutions to find ways of loaning money to you. And on the Silver Salute, a whole page on reverse mortgages. Now, this may impact some of you, but certainly understand what's going on in this article. It says reverse mortgages are often considered a last resort. It used to be seen as a last resort, as a source of income, because it was like PayPal. I mean, this is definitely last resort ways of dealing with financial issues. But now, today, in 2016, it has become a planning tool for cash-strapped homeowners. A planning tool. Think of it. Taking a house you bought with a lot of hard work and earnings, how you sacrificed to have that home. The homes you raised families in, perhaps. The joys and sorrows that were shared around the table in your home, and now it's in the years that are supposed to be a blessing to us, now having our home, our very home, at risk. Someone else has their name attached to it. Goes on to say this loan can be used for those who plan on living in their homes the rest of their life. It's a good idea. It's not a bad idea then. How many of us in senior years are going to be living in our home the rest of our life? Well, we hope that, but I would say the vast majority of that doesn't work quite that way. So it's also not a bad idea if you can afford to live in your house and pay for the expenses. Well, if we can do that, you probably don't need this. And it says it's a good source of cash for unexpected things like home repairs. Are there any home repairs that are unexpected? Really? 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 You do know the hot water heater will go out at some point, right? The roof, eventually, even church roofs, do need replacing. You will need the plumber. These aren't unexpected. It says, or for unexpected medical needs. And we know even when we hit 65, the unexpected is really the expected. And then it says, these loans are so risky, the government even had to pass a law that a counselor needs to sit down with you so you really understand the implications of what is happening. No other loan, I think, requires that but this one. Well, that's not a godly plan for the future. Want to make sure we can keep people from getting in that circumstance. And then Betty opens the paper today and she says, student debt, a rising burden for graduates. But we're the good news is the politicians are going to save us. That's how I'm reading the article. I don't care if you're Democrat, Republican, or whatever, but that's not a plan either, is it? That's not a plan either. And so at Thrivent Magazine, the last issue, it says, your daughter or son is going off to college. It's a good idea to give them a credit card, and if you need to, co-sign with them, because they will need a credit card, and they need to learn to manage it. And that means they need to go in debt, right? And you may need it to get an apartment for them. The truth is, you don't need a credit card to get an apartment. If a credit card... apartment people say that to you, just walk on down the street. And the truth is, students graduating from college often have not only incredible student loans, but even credit card loans, and start out life in some pretty dire circumstances. It's got a lot of crazy ways of doing it here in the 21st century. Wasn't like that 50 years ago. And if you look at the wisdom of the scriptures and through the ages, it speaks a different plan. Jesus, in today's gospel, he addresses the everyday issues of money. He tells this crazy story. He talks about the guy that was a scoundrel, wasted his boss's money. Terrible management. And now the day has come. He has to give an account with the books. And he's sweating bullets. Because he knows he can't squirm out of this one. He can't talk his way out of this one with the boss. He's going to get fired. And he devises this plan. I'll just start writing off debts before my boss fires me. And I'll make me a lot of friends, because I'm going to need some friends when I have nothing. And the boss actually commended him. He fired him, I'm sure. He said, got to hand it to you. Pretty shrewd with my money. Jesus says, if the dishonest people are wise and shrewd like this, the children of light, we, the children of light, need to have shrewdness and not dishonesty. He says, shrewd. Another word for shrewd is wise. We need to have a wisdom of God in the gifts he has given us. Jesus goes on to say, do not get consumed by how much or how little you have. Seek to be wise with what you have, using the wisdom of God in these matters. And seek to honor God, to be faithful and what God has given you. He says, be very careful that you don't get into the trap of serving two masters. Your master is God. Now, for most of us, when we create some financial difficulty for ourselves, the other master wealth isn't that person is that issue of the other master is there, not because we love money and we just want to love money more than God. That's usually not how it works for us in God's house. Usually what happens is we love God, and then because of financial difficulties and mistakes or things we didn't understand or think through, we get ourselves in some difficulties. And then another master has us, right? And we're wearing the chains of that other master. God doesn't give chains. We wear the chains of the other master and wonder, how are we going to get out of this and how long will it take? That's what the Israelites experienced in Egypt. Slaves to the Pharaoh. And it was like they had chains on them and they never saw light at the end of the tunnel. And the Pharaoh kept saying, more bricks. Need to have more bricks. And they worked night and day to give the Pharaoh more bricks. And then God sent a liberator, Moses. Brought him out of slavery and brought him to a new land. And gave them rich abundance, the land of milk and honey. And he said, manage this well to my glory. And there's a powerful stream of wisdom. We see it in Proverbs, the Psalms, throughout the Old Testament into the New. It's about not only managing our household, but having a great compassion in our heart for those who have nothing or little. You can read the prophets for that. In our journey of momentum, we want to, in the course of our journey, arrive at a place or see ourselves arriving at that place where St. Paul is. We mentioned where St. Paul was. He was in prison last week. We talked about that. And Paul in prison, writing to the Philippians, he said, I'm glad you're concerned about my needs, but I want you to know at this point in my life, I've learned the secret. I've learned the secret of contentment. I've learned the secret of financial peace in my life. My spiritual being and my material world are one. I've learned the secret of contentment, of financial peace. It doesn't matter if I have a lot, I've been rich, or hardly anything. I've been poor, three meals a day or no meals a day. I've learned the secret because I am doing, I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me, who is my strength and guide. I can do all things, even managing what we're talking about, because I've got Christ in my wallet too, so to speak, right? That's what he's saying. Everything under the lordship of Christ and how I'm living. And I can sleep at night in the peace of God. He says in chapter 4, I've turned all my worries and concerns about tomorrow into prayers of trust and gratitude. And then he says at the end of that letter, and the peace I've experienced, I want you to have. That's what he tells the Philippians. The peace of God, which surpasses our human understanding, I want you to have as well. Well, that's the goal of our journey, to have such peace of God in all matters of our life, especially as we manage the good riches that God has given us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Please stand. Our hymn will be sung to a different tune. Follow the organ, not the notes that you see with the words.
Rejoicing in the Spirit's work among us, we pray for the church and for the world and for all who are in need. Gracious God, giver of the feast, you have blessed your church. Inspire us and move us to care for all who hunger and thirst in this world. You nourish us richly with your word and your meal. Now send us out as signs of your living presence in the world. Help us to give as those who are handling the treasures of others, treasures intended to redeem and to sustain. Lord, in your mercy. Ruler of the earth, bring forth an abundant harvest from fields, from orchards, and from gardens. Renew those fields that will soon lie fallow, and feed and protect all of your creatures. Lord, in your mercy. God of the nations, we pray for those places in the world affected by conflict, by war, by turmoil. Especially we pray for those in Syria, for our military as it continues to engage in Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere. We pray that your perfect peace and order would be restored. Lord, in your mercy. God of our weary years, we remember before you those among us who are sick, those who are recovering from illness or surgery. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we commend all for which we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take a minute to share the peace of Christ with those around us.
We're connecting our momentum journey not just to the management of money, but particularly as we heard expressed in the scriptures and with the hymn we just sang, to connect it to how we become blessing for others. Our special ops team, that's the special opportunities team. You guys wearing your buttons? They're wearing the buttons today, Al and Ed up here, and maybe a couple of others throughout. You'll see them between the services perhaps. We'll help you with any insights on if you're looking for ideas. We're going to be handing out some stuff at the end of the service related to special ops. Legacy Journey begins in the garden room at 10:30. Some of you are a part of that and also a class again tonight. Still can register for any of the classes today. Today registrations will close. I'm going to show a video clip on mission ops.
Sometimes life moves along like any other normal day. But sometimes, in a moment, lives are changed. What could the people of God do for the kingdom of God if they were debt-free? They could provide hope. They could meet people's needs. can make a difference. They could change a life. They could help change the world. What would you do for the kingdom if you were able to take control of your money for good? Financial Peace University. Live and give like never before.
Live and give as people of God. We gather our offerings. Please stand. A great Thanksgiving hymn is number 460, Now the Silence. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Holy God, you alone are holy. You alone are God. The universe declares your praise beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath. Generations bless your faithfulness through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future. We give you thanks for your dear Son, the heart of human life, near to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering, within this meal, among your people throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to you, Holy God, through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit and your church without end. Amen. Let us join hands as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Take hold of the life that really is life. Come, take your place at the Lord's table. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We join together in the prayer. We come again to you, O God, giving you thanks that in this feast of mercy you have embraced us and healed us, making us one in the body of Christ. Go with us on our way. Equip us for every good work, that we may continue to give you thanks by embracing others with mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God Almighty, send you light and truth to keep you all the days of your life. The hand of God protect you. The holy angels accompany you. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever.
Now go in peace and remember, stand with, and care for the poor.
Thank you for listening to this episode of St. Paul's Lutheran Church's weekly worship podcasts. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.